director, Aqueelah Archie, presently serves as the Assistant Vice President of the Office of Institutional Diversity at Temple University, where her goal is to help advance diversity and inclusion in all facets of the campus community. Dr. Archie has worked in higher education for over 20 years, previously serving as the Assistant Academic Dean at Albright College. She also teaches courses in sociology, including Introduction to Sociology, American Ethnicity, Race and Racism, Race, Class, and Gender, and Statistics. My least favorite. Dr. Archie is magna cum laude graduate of Albright College, where she was a dual concentrator in psychology and sociology. While at Albright, Dr. Archie was involved in the African American Society, Orientation Steering Committee, and the Student Government Association, among other things. She was a Coleman Scholar and a member of the Society of Jacob Albright Scholars, as well as the recipient of a Gold A. Dr. Archie earned her doctorate in sociology at Temple University with a dissertation entitled Women of Cover, The Veil, and the African American Experience. A lifelong learner, she also completed facilitator training with the National Coalition Building Institute, attended the Management Development Program at Harvard University's Graduate School of Education, and most recently earned her certificate in diversity leadership at Temple University. Throughout her life and career, Dr. Archie has been committed to advancing the ideals of social justice through mentoring, program development, service, teaching, training, and consulting. While she lectures on a number of topics, she focuses mainly on issues around race, class, and gender, including minority faculty staff and student recruitment and retention, racial microaggressions, and African-American Muslim women and veiling. Dr. Archie is involved in a number of professional organizations, including the Association of Black Women in Higher Education, of which she served two terms as president of the Philadelphia chapter, the National Association for Multicultural Education, the Pennsylvania Association for Multicultural Education, the National Association of Diversity Officers in Higher Education, and the Pennsylvania Association for Liaisons and Officers of Multicultural Affairs. In her spare time, Dr. Archie loves to travel and cites Casablanca and Dubai as her favorite destinations. Dr. Archie enjoys giving back to the community, especially the Islamic community, and to Albright College. To that end, she is a member of the Alumni Association Board of Directors. Dr. Archie was the 2010 recipient of the Outstanding Leader in Education Award presented by the Association of Black Women in Higher Education. So without further ado, it's an honor to introduce you.
Thank you. Zaki was like, what you? Actually, I was talking to Sonica earlier. I thought Sonica was going to be doing the introduction, and then I thought Jamila was being, I have five sisters, and I thought Jamila was going to be doing the introduction, and I found out it was going to be Zakiya. And Sadika asked me, what should I say about you? I said, just say my name and where I work. That's all that people really need to know. So can you hear me over here? I have a tendency to be like one-sided. I do this in the classroom as well. So I'll try to project and make sure I'm talking over there. So today's topic, and I will just be up and be down, depending on how I feel, where the mood takes me. That's kind of how I do stuff. So my topic today is Islam and the social justice imperative. And so when I was asked what I wanted to talk about, I immediately thought, well, I want to talk about Islam and the social justice imperative. And then as I started thinking about it, I said, why do I want to talk about this topic? Because I'm not an expert in social justice, and I'm not an Islamic scholar. So why would I want to talk about this event, this topic? I love social justice, and I love Islam, and I thought, why not talk about what I love? So my goal for this evening is to talk a little bit about, you'll hear some autobiographical stuff about how I got really interested in this field and why I do this work, but also how my religion, I feel like, drives me to do this work and to be very engaged and very connected to these notions of social justice. So I want to start by framing the discussion a little bit about what I mean by these topics. And so you can stop me at any time if you want to ask questions. I typically do 4-hour lectures, and so I really truly can talk 4 hours without stopping. My students are sometimes very amazed. They're like, you may be able to still go, but I need a break. But feel free to stop and ask any questions as they come up. So I know you all have heard of the concept of justice, right? And so just a definition that I pulled straight out of dictionary.com, justice, the quality of being just, righteousness, equitableness, and moral rightness. How about social justice? How many of you have heard of the word social justice before? Social justice. I'll talk about it a little bit more, but just a real general kind of definition. A fair and just relationship between the individual and society. And so I think when we ask people, what does justice mean, there might be really clear things that pop in people's heads, but it may not be so clear when we think about social justice. And so for me, this notion of social justice and justice became very clear in graduate school when we had to write a paper on what was justice. And so I want to say it was maybe my second year of graduate school. And so, of course, my classmates and I wrote very traditional kinds of thing, looking at justice in religion, looking at justice in, you know, what the philosophers say about justice. And one of my friends, Cindy, is a little bit of a radical, loved her, wrote a paper that was about 4 sentences long, where she said justice is equal funding for every student. Period. Right? That was really deep. I was mad I didn't think of it. I was like, oh. I was like, that was great, Cindy. I was upset I didn't think about it. But for me, that became that notion of justice and social justice. And I'm like, yeah, that really is just. That's justice. I also see where that kind of plays into social justice. And then when I was talking about this, my mother actually asked me, okay, so you want to call it imperative. Why imperative? Right? Like, that's a... What does that mean? Are you sure you want to be that strong? And so, very quickly, imperative, we'll talk about, sometimes I do dangerous things. Imperative, absolutely necessary or required, right? Absolutely necessary or required. And so I'm making the argument that as people of faith, I was going to say people of cover, I'm thinking about my dissertation. As people of faith, I think that we're imperative. It's imperative that we think about social justice and we live socially just lives. And so that's a little bit of the argument that I'm making today. And so I want to talk about 2 key sources that I'm going to use. Of course, the Holy Quran, which is the holy book of Muslims, and the Yusuf Ali edition. And I have my edition here with me. It's very old. It's actually, I got this as a birthday gift. And it's I signed it. It's from 1983. So wow. I got it in 1983. So it's the Quran I still use today. I try to take very good care of it, but it's a little marked up, post-its. And if you go and you look up justice, there's a lot of information about justice in there if you go to the index, justice. And also the hadith. So the hadith are sayings and practices of the Prophet. And so I rely on Sahih Muslim and Sahih Bukhari. There are a number of different hadith. Those are just the 2 that I'm most familiar with and that I use most often. And so one of the things I wanted to do was kind of pull out some Quranic and hadith support of this notion of justice and just how important being just individuals are. And I can say there was a lot, right? There was a lot. There were a lot of things that I could have put down, but I pulled 3 in particular because they really resonated with me when I read them. And the first one, and again, I don't necessarily like to read, but I don't know how clear that is on the screen, and so I'll read it to you. And this is from chapter 4, verse 135, and chapter 4 is entitled The Woman, but it's, O ye who believe. And my mother, I don't know if she remembers, she used to read this to me as a child. O ye who believe, stand firmly out for justice as witnesses to God, even as against yourselves or your parents or your kin, and whether it be against rich or poor or for God can both best protect both, right? And so we have to stand out for justice even when we have family members who are being unjust and thinking about ourselves. I think my parents used to use it as like a Jedi parent trick to get us to tell on ourselves, right? So, it wasn't until I was older to get that. Look at all my siblings laughing. They totally get it. That's why we heard this verse more than once. O ye who believe, stand out firmly for God as a witness to fair dealings, and let not the hatred of others to you make you swerve to wrong and depart from justice. Right? And so even people who are unjust to us deserve our justice. They deserve justice from us. Behold, this is from a hadith, and it's on the Book of Governance. Behold, the dispensers of justice will be seated on the pulpits of light beside God, on the right side of the merciful, exalted, and glorious. Either side of the being is the right side of being, of both being equally meritorious. The dispensers of justice are those who do justice in their rules and matters relating to their families and all that they undertake to do. So that's pretty powerful, being just. If you are a just person, you will be sitting next to God. So social justice, right? There's a lot of evidence for justice. We've talked about it. Social justice. I'm in the field of education, and so we have a lot of different definitions of social justice, and a lot of them are about education. So I will share one of my favorite quotes, definitions of social justice, just because I use it so much. I was home, my sister was actually reading from the book. I was like, yeah, that book, that's one of my favorite books. And so Adams, Bell, and Griffin work in education, and they define social justice as a process and a goal. And so the goal of social justice education, because again, they're educators, is full and equal participation of all groups in a society that is mutually shaped to meet their needs. Social justice includes a vision of society that is equitable and all members are physically and psychologically safe and secure. Right? Physically and psychologically safe and secure. Another definition that is a little bit more broader that I just stumbled upon a couple days ago on CARE's website. Social justice, in its broadest sense, means that socially all groups, classes, races, etc., of individuals should at a minimum have equal access to education, equal job opportunities, and equal access to the basic necessities of life. More than that, however, an individual should never feel their way of life or belief system is threatened in a socially just society, provided they are abiding by the laws of their land. And that was, I found that on the CARE webpage, and I was really appreciative of the fact that CARE, which is the Council of American Islamic Relations, was talking about social justice. And really this, the last part was really powerful to me. More than that, however, an individual should never feel their way of life or belief system is threatened in a socially just society, right? That is really critical, again, about how we live, how we govern, in Islamic societies, non-Islamic societies. So does anybody have any initial reactions to those definitions? Because the teacher of me can't help but to hear from some people in the audience. Anybody have any initial reactions, mood, thoughts, surprising? Now, I won't call on anybody.
It sounds so simple to do.
Absolutely.
Yet it's so difficult to do.
Absolutely.
You know, the whole part of being just to those that are unjust to you takes a lot.
Yes.
It really does.
Absolutely. And I also think, too, that, you know, when I think about it from a global kind of societal level, I feel like there are some societies, and I don't know if America is one of them, where there is this greater sense of community. And I feel like when we live in a very individualistic society or individualistic societies, I think that it's almost even a greater... it's a greater hardship almost to kind of think about social justice. Because I think a lot of times we think about like me, 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 and I think it's really kind of subtle, kind of referencing that we get in the media and television and the things we read. Very, very kind of individualistic.
Well, my first thought was that we're not living in a socially just society.
Well, that's not us. I guess I could have started there, right? When extreme poverty is, I was just talking with my mother about poverty and how for the longest time there was always this conversation about the gap between the rich and the poor getting wider. And for a while that wasn't true in a real kind of sense, right? In a real kind of statistically significant kind of way. And now it is, right? And so this notion of a shrinking middle class and a greater kind of disparity, that's real. right? And so again, it's the question of, are we living in a socially just society? Anybody else before I move on? And yes.
And I'm going back. I don't know what the hadith is.
Okay, so I'm sorry. So the hadith are a series.
Okay, you didn't know.
Oh, I'm sorry. So the hadith are a series of practices and sayings of the Prophet. And so they help to inform what's in the Holy Quran. So there may be a directive in the Holy Quran. For example, the Holy Quran says to pray. You look to the hadith to see how.
Okay.
And so a lot of the, and so one of the reasons why I use Sahih Muslim and Sahih Bukhari is because they're defined as being very sound. And so when you're talking about the sayings of the Prophet, there's a chain of transmission. And so, you know, it's one of those things like if I tell you something, you may actually get it correct, and you may get it correct, but by the time it gets... So Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim tend to be very sound in terms of their transmission, where there are other hadiths where it's come through, well, the Prophet said this to, you know, 25 people ago, and by the time it's gotten to this person. But yes, thank you for that question. Right, so it's the sayings, and so I will read some hadith where the Prophet says, you know, oh, believers, and so the Prophet is actually addressing his believers, and so you have those in the hadith. So when I was thinking about social justice and some of my earliest kind of influencers of social justice, I will admit I didn't immediately think about the hadith and the sayings of the Prophet. And I don't know why. I mean, like, some of you may shake your heads when I say this person, but I was like, Cesar Chavez was, honest to goodness, like the first person that I remember. And even earlier. Because let me tell you what happened. I was in the third grade, and I was 8 years old, and my teacher was Mrs. Rothenberger. And you know, back then I thought Mrs. Rothenberger was probably 30 because she was a seasoned teacher, but I thought she was like 100. I just really did. I don't know why I always thought she was like, I was like, Mrs. Rothenberger must be 100 years old. And so I had her at a time where, again, I was 8 years old, but I started to develop a lot of consciousness at that point. And I remember seeing a news report about Cesar Chavez. And I just remember being so moved by the fact that he was fighting to get like better treatment for farm workers. That's all I knew. I didn't even know what a farm worker was. But all I knew was that he was fighting to get better treatment for people. And so we had to write a paper on an American hero. And so Mrs. Rothenberger gives out this paper, and you know, it's like Abraham Lincoln and Thomas Edison and, you know, Benjamin Franklin. And I was like, oh, I want to write my paper on Cesar Chavez. And Mrs. Rothenberger was like, first of all, what do you know about Cesar Chavez? And I'm not sure we would call him an American hero. And I remember just thinking, no, he is a hero because he's fighting for a better way of life for people. And I just remember the exasperation in Mrs. Rothenberger's face when I made this kind of push. And I don't know if my parents remember this, but I came home and told them I wanted to write this paper on Cesar Chavez, and she told me I couldn't. And my parents were like, well, you have a decision to make. Right, and I became an activist that day because I wrote the paper on Cesar Chavez. And again, it was a paper. What could I say? He united the farm workers. That's all I had. It wasn't like we could Google and go do research. But I remember handing that paper in, thinking, you know, he's risking a lot more than I am, and I think what he's doing is powerful and wonderful. So I'm going to hand this paper in. And I did. I got an A. I mean, but you know, and Mrs. Rothenberg was like, yeah, okay. If you want to make that argument, make it. You know, poor Mrs. Rothenberger, she was also the teacher where I was boycotting Thanksgiving because I was like, I don't want to participate in the genocide of my Native American sisters and brothers. And she just kind of looked at me and was like, huh, this little girl. But she has no idea how much of an impact she had on my life, because she kind of gave me the space to kind of be that person, and I really think put me on this journey. But Cesar Chavez, the first person that popped into my mind as being a social justice advocate. Also, Sophie Scholl and Omar Mukhtar pop up. Two very different situations, similar outcomes, execution by the state. But again, fighting for the rights of other people. And so you have Sophie Scholl, who was an anti, and I don't know if you all remember hearing her story, she was an anti-Nazi activist. And was, you know, her and her brother, and they had a White Rose Society, and they were fighting against Nazism. And so they were standing up and handing out flyers, and they all got caught and they all got executed. And so she got executed, I think she was around by guillotine, around 19 years old, but I remember thinking about, you know, just how powerful she was to really kind of push for the socially just society. And this is before the real height of the Holocaust and Nazism. This is the beginning of it. And again, willing to risk her life. And then, of course, there's Omar Mukhtar, who, you know, I remember seeing the movie Lion of the Desert and then learning more about his story, who for 20 years led the Libyan resistance against the colonization of Italians. And again, thinking, you know, this is a person who's fighting really, really hard, you know, for freedom, for honor, for the rights of his people. Of course, I have to talk about Dr. Martin Luther King and Malcolm X. Again, civil rights activists who had a real bent towards, you know, social justice. And I think sometimes people forget just how involved in social justice both Malcolm X and Martin Luther King were. And again, looking beyond race. And so, you know, Dr. Martin Luther King was very much involved and workers' rights, and he, you know, in addition to kind of civil rights. And I think people sometimes forget that. And again, it's kind of the individualistic kind of thing. Well, it's my issue, it's my problem, so I need to be concerned about me and mine. But we're all part of a larger community. We're all part of humanity. And then, of course, it really didn't hit on me the role of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as a social justice activist until I was in graduate school. And I had a course with Dr. Khaled Blankenship, who I know some of you know because he's spoken here before. And we had a course on the autobiography of the Prophet. And so it was a semester-long course. And I ended up writing a final paper on the Prophet's treaty with the Jews. And so reading about the treaty and learning about the Prophet's life, I feel like on some level I had missed that. And all the history that I had gotten, really kind of missing the role that the Prophet played in social justice and making life better for everybody, the Muslims, the non-Muslims, the believers, the non-believers, you know, that people's basic needs, basic right to humanity was important. And so when I started forming this list, I'm like, yeah, this is, I was being, you know, I was being raised and taught in this world of social justice and not even understanding it was a world of social justice. Because again, the concept of social justice, it wasn't coined until around like 1840, some of the philosophers. So it wasn't like this word was always out there. And we really just started using it in this diversity work, I want to say like 10, 15 years ago, where we really started talking about social justice. But the Prophet was talking about social justice at the time, and really thinking about enriching the lives of people. And so, how did that happen? What are the examples of the ways in which we see that? And I think the biggest indicators of social justice, thinking about it from an Islamic perspective, are, again, two key Islamic principles. And first is zakat. And zakat is the third of five pillars of Islam. So I'm sure some of you have maybe been to a workshop or heard about the five pillars of Islam. Zakat is the third of five pillars. And so it literally means that which purifies. And so it's mandatory almsgiving, right? It's you are required to give a certain percentage of your wealth. Was that your phone?
No.
Oh, okay. You know, it's funny, when my students' phones ring in the classroom, I mark them absent. They're so mad. I do. They're so mad at me. I can't do that today. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay.
Nancy's here.
It's okay. It's not a problem at all. So mandatory, it's customarily 2.5% of a Muslim savings and wealth. And both Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, again, have books on zakat, which, again, is critical. And so, again, to me, zakat is the epitome, right, of social justice, because it is a tax and it's gone and it goes to the community, right, to help the poor and the disenfranchised in Islamic communities, Islamic countries. And then there's sadaqah, name of my dear little baby sister. Sadaqah. Charity is voluntary. And again, there are a number of references in the Quran and Hadith to zakat and sadaqah. And so I want to read just a couple very powerful quotes about the role of both of these in the Islamic community. So, sadaqah. It's due on every joint of a person every day the sun rises. Administering of justice between two men is also a sadaqah. And assisting a man to ride upon his beast or helping him load his luggage upon it is a sadaqah. And a good word is a sadaqah. And every step that you take towards prayer is a sadaqah. And removing of harmful things from the pathway is a sadaqah. That's from Sahih Muslim number 1009. What are your thoughts about that? Have you ever kind of conceptualized charity in that way?
I just remember always when we were little, removing something from a path.
Yes, I still...
And I still, that has been instilled in me from this day. If there's a branch on the sidewalk, it gets moved. If there's a can in the street, it gets moved.
I almost got hit by a car because there was a... I mean, I guess that's good or bad. I don't know. It was a branch in the middle of the street. So I was like, ah! I got out my car and moved it.
I stopped for stuff like that as well. It's just, you know, and it's not one of those things that you think about, but then once you're told about it, it's like something that's
people call me
simple.
Captain Planet, because I actually walk around with gloves sometimes because I'm always picking up litter. Right? I mean, it's true, right? But people don't think about how that's charity, right? How that's thinking about our environment, right? Because we'll talk a little bit about environmental justice, right? Moving something out the path of somebody's way, right, and how that makes their lives better and how that contributes to the functioning of our society. The Prophet said, "Oh, Muslim women, none of you should consider even a sheep's trotter too insignificant to give to her neighbor." I don't know what a sheep's trotter is, but I'm assuming it's just a small little part of the sheep. Right. And the thing is, even the smallest things that we do.
Like the sheep's hoof.
Oh, okay.
Thank you. Like a pig's trotter.
Yeah, I know. Today you have, you know, Google. You can have the answer in a couple of seconds. What to try to look. We have people trying to figure out a trotter is. But the point behind this hadith is that it doesn't matter how little something may be, right? It can be sadaqah. It could be charity, right? I also kind of like that quote because I met a Muslim once who said the Prophet never talked to women. And I said, oh, yeah?
It's a hoof.
It's a hoof. It's a hoof. Thank you. All right. That was good. There we go.
Right? Do your students look things up like that while you're...
They, no, because I ban phones. I ban phones. I know. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, do not withhold your money, for if you do so, Allah will withhold his blessings from you. Right. And that's, again, powerful about... thinking, again, social justice is this notion of equitable distribution of resources. But I do want to say that Islam accepts an unequal distribution of resources. And I know people boo, right? But the truth is, there are going to be people who have more money than other people. Right? That is, you know, and there's stuff in the Hadith and the Quran. Again, because some of it is tied to deeds and what you do, so that's not going to be the same. And it's funny, I was reading about a brother in the time after the death of the Prophet who was a friend of the companion of the Prophet, Uthman, and he argued that everybody should just put their money in and there'd be an equal distribution of money. And they banished him. They were like, you gotta leave Mecca. And that's really what they said, you have to leave Mecca. And they were like, because that's really not what the principles of Islam say, right? Because some people do work hard and they do the right things and there are certain behaviors that they engage in that will contribute to that wealth. So social justice in Islam is not saying that there should be no disparities in wealth. But what it does say, if the distribution of wealth in a community is inequitable and unfair, social peace is threatened, right? And again, that's what social justice is about equal opportunity, not equal outcomes, right? Equal opportunity. And so again, if the distribution of wealth in a community is inequitable and unfair, social peace is threatened. And so again, in order to maintain social peace, it's important that we don't have these big income disparities. And we have them here in the United States. We have huge income disparity. And so I really have gotten into kind of environmental justice and food security and food insecurity and just thinking about, yes?
We have huge disparities also in opportunity.
Absolutely.
And kids don't all get the same education.
Absolutely. And that's the big, and that's what a socially just society should provide, right? That doesn't mean that the outcomes are not going to be the same. The outcomes will likely be different. But it's again, it's about those opportunities that are critical, right? And so when we think about how schools are funded, going back to what my friend had said about justice being equal funding, right, where you have, I have friends who worked in the Philadelphia School District trying to work their way through college, and literally I had a friend, and this was back in the, I want to say the early 90s, who was literally teaching out of a book where JFK was still president. Now this is in the 90s, and it's like, how do students get updated information? Well, we had to make photocopies. Compare that to students who are educated in schools that have state-of-the-art resources. Every student gets a laptop. There's high-tech labs. There's high-tech facilities, right? And then there's very different outcomes. And I think because we are a very individualistic society and we believe in this notion of meritocracy, right, that if you just work hard, you can be successful, those students who have a particular outcome are viewed very differently than students who are educated in some of those, you know, highly funded schools. And again, justice. Do we need to think about how we fund schools, right? Because again, think about what this says. If the distribution of wealth in the community is inequitable and unfair, social peace is threatened. Social peace, right? We can think about what's going on today. And I have students and friends who, like, they really don't care. Right? They honestly don't care about, you know, poor working class kids in inner cities because they truly have bought into this meritocracy, which I call a myth. I think it's a myth of meritocracy. And really I've had people say, well, why should I care about this? And I was like, well, maybe you should just care about it from a purely economic perspective. Because when they want something, they're not robbing their neighborhoods, they're coming to yours. Right? And they're jacking your cars. And my friends looked at me and said, oh, maybe I should care. Yeah, maybe you should. Because it's the right thing to do, but if, let me speak your language. That's what I tell them. I'm like, let me speak your language, son. Right? Right? It's the right thing to do, but what social peace, social, you know, social justice leads to social peace. That's what we have to work tomorrow towards. Again, economic, social justice, basic human needs should be met. And I think a society defines what basic human needs to be. But again, there are people who go to bed hungry every single night. Right? Every night. Or they don't have enough food to eat. And again, I made this really connection. I was on a panel not too long ago about mass incarceration. And so I was making this kind of argument about food insecurity and how that impacts students' educational opportunities and how that could lead down to a path of crime. Some people looked at me like I was nuts. I had somebody who commented in the newspaper about, I don't even know what this hogwash is or something. But, you know, imagine going to bed at night hungry and then getting up in the morning and there's this expectation that you're going to be 100% and be able to sit in a classroom and be, you know, active and involved. Or if you are having breakfast, eating like a, you know, a cupcake or a donut with lots of juice and you're all sugared up before you even get in the classroom. Right, and so the connections between food insecurity, which a lot of people suffer from, and some of these other social ills and problems. And so I'm a sociologist by training, so everything is connected to me. So basic human needs should be met. Again, safety, security, you know, being fed, having a roof over your head, those things are critical. And again, Islamic social justice entails, among other things, eliminating economic exploitation of the weak, right? Eliminating the economic exploitation of the weak. And do we give people decent wages, right? And so now there's this big debate about how much do we pay people, right? And so we pay people like $15 an hour. And again, I do a lot of research on poverty. When you think about what people get and where that is supposed to, how that's supposed to stretch out. And last, you can see how all of these things are connected, right? So eliminating economic exploitation of the weak. And in some ways, that feels somewhat anti-capitalistic in some ways, because we think about, you know, the hallmark of capitalism being cheap labor, and it's kind of arguing something else. So just, again, interesting things to think about and how they're connected. And so, again, I've been talking about social justice being an imperative, especially when we think about it from an economic perspective. And so I pulled out a couple more verses. I think one is from the Hadith and one is from the Quran that just feels very, very important to me and really kind of drives home this imperative, right? Something that you should do. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, said every Muslim has to give to charity. Just every Muslim has to give to charity. The people ask, oh, Allah's Prophet, if someone has nothing to give, what will he do? He should work with his hands and benefit himself and also give in charity from what he earns. The people further asked, if he cannot find even that, he replied, he should help the needy who appeal for help. Then the people asked, if he cannot do that, he replied, then he should perform good deeds and keep away from evil deeds, and this will be regarded as charitable deeds. Right? Anything resonate with you with that? I'm looking over at the men who have been very silent.
No, I want to regress, go back to Sadaqa.
Yes.
You know, as growing up, we were taught to do exactly what we should be doing as far as if you're riding public transportation. You get up out of your seat, if you see a female, someone carrying a baby or a baggage, opening the doors.
Yeah.
These things were taught to us. But I don't see that happening today.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I think we've moved away from our moral and religious centers, and yeah, I think that's why it's important to have these conversations.
Yeah.
We've lost our sense of righteousness and morality.
Yeah.
And again, it happens. So I was on a bus once, and it was really interesting. Is the bus was jam packed. This is really interesting how this works. The bus was packed, and there was a young woman on. She had to be like 8 months expecting. She had a little girl with her, and it was clear she was going to a party or trying to arrange a party. She had all these balloons, and she was standing. And I was just, I couldn't even believe it. So I get on the bus, I kind of wave through, and somebody got up, and they said, hey, ma'am, you want my, like, got up for me. And part of it is about, you know, how Muslims are perceived in Philadelphia. There's in some places, there's a lot of respect there. And so I gave my seat to her. She was, like, so grateful. But I was like, nobody saw her come. Like, there was a time, that would never happen. That would absolutely positively never happen, or giving up a seat for an elderly. And so I think part of the problem, again, is that we've become so individualistic. I think on some level, we've become very materialistic, you know, and we forget all of this, right? The righteousness. Yes?
Along those lines, there's a young man, doesn't live too far from me, and he's also in a chair. He has cerebral palsy. And anyhow, he was at one point given a job through some kind of a social service thing. But what he was paid was demeaning.
Right.
And
right.
The way things worked out, he wound up giving up the job. And it really bothers me because I'm a retired special ed teacher. It really bothers me that there isn't some kind of job that he could get, that he could be offered. you know, they're talking now about raising the wage. At least give him minimum wage.
Wow. Right.
And let him feel like he is worth something.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's just, to me, it's embarrassing.
Right, right.
And I know of another gentleman, both he and his wife have MS, and right now he's out of work.
Right.
And she's working as a nurse, but they're homeless. And this shouldn't be in our society.
You're absolutely right. And that's about, because again, I think it goes back to the key point about our society not being a socially just society. And I feel as though as people of faith, right, we have to be the models of that. And we have to push and inspire other people, right, in our lives to think about that. It's really interesting. And again, I also think we have to, you know, look at the commonalities that we have, right? And so when we talk about having a decent wage, that impacts a lot of groups of people, right? People of color, people who may have disabilities, single mothers. Again, there's a lot of exploitation that goes on in a number of different communities. Right, and so it affects a lot of communities. And so part of what I think about social justice and pushing these social justice ideas is working across community, right? It was really interesting. I moderated a panel on Wednesday, and it was on disabilities. And there was a woman who was in a wheelchair, and she was Jewish, and had just started partnering with Black Lives Matter. She's like, because we have kind of the same issues when we think about how our bodies are devalued in American society. And so it was an interesting connection that she made for people in the room, because people never made that connection. And she's very involved in Black Lives Matter, and she has a number of Black Lives Matter advocates who are now working on issues around access for people with disabilities. But that was her thinking outside her narrow community and thinking about a larger community. And I think that's key when we're talking about social justice and creating a society, right, that is truly socially just. But the easiest way, like the imperative that every Muslim has to give in charity, every Muslim, right? That doesn't feel any more, I don't think you can get any more imperative than that. And from the Quran, which actually, you know, I read this a lot, this verse a lot. I think every time I read it, I cry. I really do. Because it talks about righteousness, right? And so, you know, I'm from Philadelphia, and Philadelphia is a very interesting Islamic community, and so I'm always kind of pushing about what they consider righteousness, right? Because there's this, okay, if you do this, then you're righteous. And I'm like, there's hungry people in our communities. That doesn't feel righteous to me. But this is from the Quran, Surah 2. Righteousness is not that you turn your faces towards the east or the west. But it is righteousness to believe in God and the last day and the angels and the book and the messengers. To spend of your substance out of love for him, nothing more than love for him, for your kin, for orphans, for the needy, for the wayfarer, for those who ask, and for the ransom of slaves. To be steadfast in prayer and practice regular charity. And that is repeated throughout the Quran, right? Where I was reading a hadith where somebody was saying, like, you know, why don't I be Muslim, and how do I show I'm Muslim? And it says repeatedly about regular prayer and charity, more so than anything else. Doesn't say about dress, you know, because I think as Muslims we love to talk about hijab and dress and covering. And so, yeah, I'm banned from a couple mosques in Philadelphia. It's okay. Yeah, I'm good. There's a lot. You know, because I've had people who've been like, that sister isn't covered enough. I say, well, have you asked that sister if she's hungry? Mm-hmm. Right? Does she have a job? Does she have a roof over her head? Mm-hmm. Like, what are we thinking about? Like, why are we worried about whether or not her sleeves, maybe she's hungry. Like, do we really know, right? To me, that's what Islam is about, right? Not to say that covering is not important. But we have communities where people are dying and starving, right? And we're worried about the degree to which somebody's covered, or that brother's, you know, pants are too long, or his shirt is too tight. Does that brother have a job? Have you asked that brother, did he go to bed safe, right? Has he eaten? Where are our priorities, right? As people of faith, as Muslims, right? Where God is saying, practice regular charity, right? That's what's critical. And so to me, being Muslim means it's imperative that we practice charity and that we think about social justice. Yes?
you speak about charity, you know, I know that there's a saying where it says, even a smile is charity.
Yes.
Yes.
And, you know, you were talking about the lady on the bus, and I couldn't help but think about how people now are with their cell phones or walking in the street.
Yes.
And there's so many interactions,
yeah,
personal interactions, that just don't take place anymore.
Yeah.
Because someone's got their face in the phone or they're on the phone, even, you know, at the grocery store, at the checkout, and...
Right, and people are taken aback. I say hi to everybody. Like, hey, you know, people wonder, do I know you? No, you're a human being, and I love you. Like, that's it. That's why I'm saying hello to you. It's very interesting. I was in a grocery store the other day, and passed by these two older African American men, and you know, this, oh, hey, how you doing? They moved out the way. I said, hello, how are you? Hope you're having a good day. And you know, they walked away and came back, and they're like, can we? I just want to say something to you. There, you are the first person who's covered like you are, who's spoken back, who said hello. He's like, what is that about? Well, I was like, well, you have an hour? I said, I tell you what that's about. But I was embarrassed and ashamed, right? Because as Muslims, we're told when somebody gives you a green, you give it back.
Yep.
Better than what they gave you, right? And there's not all picky nuance about who that person is and who is deserving of that. And that was so disappointing, right? To say, you're the first Muslim who's actually said hello, right? And I walked out that store, I was like, you know what? We have work to do.
Did he mean just females or?
Females. Well, he said dressed
yeah.
like this, so I'm assuming a covered woman. And I did explain a little bit about gender and some women not wanting to, you know, have a conversation with a man. And that's how some people, and he's like, okay, we get that. But it's like, you know, we're just human beings and just... He's like, we're just nice guys, we're just old men, we like people, we just say hello, you know, when we see people. And I was like, I get it. And they were like, you made our day. And I was like, oh, thank you. So living socially just as Muslims and people of faith, I think some of the things that I think
great.
That we can do. I put this quote, I cut and paste it, but I want to read directly from the Quran about the imperative. Because there's some plurals in there that I missed. So, it is not righteousness, this is from the Yusuf Ali translation, that you turn your faces towards east or west, but it is righteousness to believe in God and the last day and the angels and the book and the messengers, to spend of your substance out of love for him, for your kin, your orphans, for the needy, for the wayfarer, for those who ask, and for the ransom of slaves, to be steadfast in prayer, and practice regular charity. So I want to read directly because I thought I might have mistyped that wrong. But just to end, because I know I'm standing between you and food, I know how that goes. Just really quickly, living socially just as Muslims and people of faith. And so we talked a little bit about the economics, right? So work to end homelessness, poverty, food insecurity, wealth inequality, etc. I feel as though to be people of faith, to believe in principles of social justice, and to live in a socially just society, we have to work to eliminate these things. And I do believe, you know, people are like, oh, when you know, there'll never be an end to poverty. And I don't know, I just have to believe that somehow we can uplift people and lift the standard of people. We're the basic. Right? We have people whose basic needs aren't being met. And we definitely have to work to do that. Education. Educational inequality. Women's education. We talked a little bit about funding and the difference that funding makes. And again, it's all a pattern. What kind of elementary school you go to determines your high school, determines the college, determines outcomes. Right? Critical. Politics. And I'm talking about all these things because these are things that, again, when you look through the Hadith and the Quran and you look through religious texts, that there's more than just about economics. There's a lot of stuff that highlights social justice. So politics, voting. There's a big debate in the Islamic community now about voting. And, you know, some people say you should vote. Some people say you don't vote. I'm a big believer in voting. Because, again, there are policies that are being put forth that they're socially unjust. And you really can't speak out against those policies or for certain policies if you're not engaged in the political process. It's funny because I said a couple things that, you know, with this last election cycle that's been very, very interesting to me about, you know, what's going on with politics. And I've said it publicly kind of everywhere that I've been that If Donald Trump is elected president and I disappear, it is not willingly. I just want you to know, he has taken me, sent me somewhere, look for me. I've told people that publicly. But also, where was Tiff? Nope, I'm going, I'm hidden away somewhere. And also, it really makes me think about a political campaign. Like, I've been toying around with, do I ever want to do politics? And I've really been thinking about it, because, there's a part of me that's like, it doesn't seem like you have to be qualified, really. And I'm not just talking about Trump, I'm talking about a lot of the candidates who don't have real, tangible ways of how these things are going to get done, but is that the way to go?
That'd be
a
running mate.
Oh, goodness. That'd be a running mate, right? But again, when we think about politics, eradicating mass incarceration, right? Mass incarceration. We are, of the, I don't like this term, of the developed nations, have the highest rates of mass incarceration. And so again, it's this thing about a just society. Why are people incarcerated? 9 times out of 10, they're incarcerated because their basic needs aren't being met, right? And as a society, again, the connection, if we can become a more socially just society, we won't see as much incarceration. Right, people. What we think about, drugs. People who take drugs and arrested for drugs. Why are they taking drugs? Mm-hmm. A lot of times because their basic needs are not being met. Right. The environment. We should be environmentally just. There is stuff in the Islamic text about the environment. Right. About this being God's earth. Right. So environmental justice. Litter. Litter. I'm going to tell a story. My husband's not here. I got married in August. And so we were driving. My husband told me, look away. And I'm like, so I look away. He threw something out his car. Mm. He had a bag of chips, and he threw the empty bag of chips. Oh, man.
It's in trouble.
We drove back around and picked that empty bag of chips up.
Mm-hmm. Good.
We did. He's going to be mad. Don't tell him I told you. We went and picked it up.
Good.
We're like, that's not, what's that?
It's going on YouTube.
I'm gonna tell him. Don't watch YouTube. He won't watch it. Don't watch it on YouTube, right? We fussed the whole way home. Like, why would you do that? I'll tell him. I'll say, let's go watch it on YouTube, and then I'll call him away. I'll be like,
tell me you have some chips.
Oh goodness! Oh yeah, yeah. I'll tell him to trash out litter bug, right? Social relationships. I feel like that I have to say this. There should be no racism in Islam.
Yes,
there is racism in Islam. Mm-hmm. There is racism in Islam. It makes me throw up in my mouth a little just to say it.
Mm-hmm.
There's racism in Islam, and that is counter to everything that we are taught about the beauty of Islam. Mm-hmm. And I think about, again, I referenced Malcolm X earlier, and how, he became a Sunni Muslim because he went to Hajj,
mm-hmm.
right, and saw all different people. He saw a reality that he didn't see in the United States, right? So no racism, no classism in Islam, working to eradicate the isms. And I believe if we do this, right, relying on our faith, because it is all there. And we were talking earlier, where's the brother's not here, was talking about the importance of reiterating that not just the book, but there are books, right, that Muslims believe in various books, and as easy as it is, it's in all the religious texts, right, about eradicating these isms. This isn't a wholly Islamic concept. It's in the other religious traditions as well, right, about eradicating these isms. And only then can we have a socially just world, which to me is a righteous world, which to me is a religious world. And so I think I'm way over time, but just really quickly, if anybody had any questions, final thoughts before we go to food, and let me just give you a time check. It is 7:53. I think I was only supposed to talk to 7:30, but there was a little break. We started late, so I think I might be still an hour. Any questions or any final feedback or thoughts? Yes.
Do you think that we've made any progress towards social justice? Now, you said earlier that you think we've lost our moral compass.
Yes. You know what I think is happening is I think we're having more conversations about it. I think we're starting to kind of really acknowledge and think about strategies and ways. And so that's a starting point, because this is, I think it's hard for people to kind of acknowledge our weaknesses and where we've kind of gone astray. So I do see, I mean, I see progress in certain areas, but I feel like, you know, where we should be, is we have a long way to go. But we are talking about it more. And we are, again, I think we're willing to talk about what some of the issues are. You know, there was a long time when we wouldn't talk about mass incarceration, right? And now we're talking about mass incarceration, right? Or racism in a real meaningful kind of way. And now we're talking about racism in a more meaningful kind of way. And so all my work is about dialogue and creating space where we have these conversations.
Yeah. How do you begin to combat those that don't want social justice?
Right. So, you know, wait, I'm not going to say that. So I think it's funny because sometimes I just talk out my mouth. I got to be careful what I say sometimes, especially since I'm on YouTube. So I think part of it is that having a willingness to speak up, right? And I think sometimes we do that, and our silence often is read as acceptance. And so really when the opportunity presents itself to speak up, it's interesting, again, I do a lot of dialogue work, and part of the challenge for me is loving people that I think are not socially just, you know, like loving racists. And it's, you know, and it's hard because, you know, people are racist because they're hurt too. They're feeling some kind of pain. There's something wrong with them because we're not born that way. So have they gotten off a path? Do they need more spirituality? Do they need more love? I don't know what they need. But I think part of my job is somebody who believes in social justice is understanding what their needs are. Are their basic needs being met, right? And then calling them out whenever the opportunity presents. And that's hard. I always think about those, you know, those what would you do, you know, in the ABC news show, like what would you do? And I'm constantly like, what, like, would I speak up in that case? Would I? And I like to think that I would. And so it is. It's speaking up. It's educating. I often get students in the classroom who have particular kind of beliefs just because they're not educated. They don't know, right? And so educating people when you can, and then for me it's also an issue of choosing your battles really wisely, right? I've met people, I've had students in the classroom who's like, you know, I can't change them. So all I can do is change the way that I relate to them and respond to them. And I've actually told students, I'm gonna pray for you. Yes. Religion in the classroom, really? But I've said, I've actually told students, I'm going to pray for you, right? Because I can't educate you, it's not working. I'm going to pray for you.
I'm so glad that you said that, because I think, well, say something about our power of prayer. We've just been, we're people of faith, and we're in a room, and we've
yes.
been praying.
Yes, yes. I believe in the power of prayer. Absolutely, positively, and I do. And it's something, again, it's something that we can always do. I truly believe in it. You know, it's funny because I was just doing a workshop on Tuesday, and saying, this is really hard work, right? Advocating for a socially just world is really hard work. And so I think one of the strategies is surrounding yourself with people that you can draw energy from and be inspired from. Right, so I'm drawing energy from everybody in this room because I was tired when I walked in, but I'm not tired anymore. Right, so I've drawn that energy from people. And so for me, it's like, it's almost like gearing up for battle. I go out, do what I have to do, and then I come back to a community of people who get it. And it's having the willingness to step outside of your comfort zone, right, with people who don't get it. And so I've met people who've been Islamophobic. I actually have friends on Facebook who are Islamophobic. They say, like, stuff against Muslims. And I'm like, hello, do you know I'm Muslim? You know, but then I try to educate when I can. And then there have been times I've literally said, you know, I can't even be your friend anymore. So, goodbye, good luck, I'm going to pray for you.
Going back to giving sadaqah or giving charity in Islam, is it aimed only towards the Muslim or?
No, it's for the community, Muslims and non-Muslims. Okay. Absolutely. It's for the community. And I think that was what's so beautiful about, you know, the message of the Prophet, learning about his history. About when we're talking about justice and basic needs, he was talking and he was extolling people. This isn't just about Muslims in a society. It's about non-Muslims. It's about everybody. Right? And that's very clear in all the hadith and all and every bit of the Quran. It's about society. And again, you know, that makes me think about, you know, certain places where, you know, people can't practice their faith or they're mistreated in Islamic countries because they have a different faith. And I always say, like, if people would just sit and ask themselves, what would the Prophet do? Like, that's the, like, mm-hmm. what would the Prophet do this?
No, I
don't. Really?
Not.
Right? And so, again, I think having those conversations, I believe in interfaith activities, because I think at the end of the day, we have the same issues, right? Mm-hmm. We want a socially just world where people are free to live happy and safe and secure.
Right.
And so I really do believe in doing interfaith work. And again, there's a lot of Muslims who aren't into interfaith work, and that's okay. That's the beauty of Islam. There's enough space for a lot of different ways of kind of being in the world. So with that, I will just say thank you so much.
Could I have one more question?
Yes.
Yeah, one more.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Going back to the political arena.
Uh-huh.
I'm with you. I cannot see if someone doesn't vote. Mm-hmm. But the thing probably, one of the problems I think it is, we have so many candidates who profess to be a religion.
Yes.
You see, and they're not practicing it.
Right.
And I think if they did that, I think this would be a just world.
Absolutely.
If they actually lived their religion.
Right.
Absolutely.
And that's mm-hmm. what's happening now. They say it
but
to get
don't.
Votes, but they don't do it. But I believe mm-hmm. that we need to get, people of all faith mm-hmm. need to get involved in the political arena.
Absolutely.
So we can really look at persons who are claiming to be what they claim to be.
Right.
And to make sure that they do what they say.
Hold people accountable. It's accountability.
Yeah.
Right? We have to hold them accountable. We have to hold each other accountable.
Each other accountable. True.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Just one more thing. Do you happen to have like a favorite source or a website or something that engages in like local social justice activities? Because there's so much out there, you know, to just go on and look for something to get involved in.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite?
So there's a social justice kind of institute and group that I'm part of. It's funny, my sister's reading that book. If you look up, I think the name is like Marianne Bell. And they're not a social justice group per se, as much as it is social justice kind of resources and strategies and what we can do. But I'm involved in just a lot of different social justice things in the community, right? And so the Association of Black Women in Higher Ed is all about equality in education. A lot of those organizations that my sister had talked about, they're all social justice organizations in one way or another. But a big part of it, I think, is as people of faith is modeling that as well. Mm-hmm. Like, just to model that. You know, you never know who's kind of paying attention or who will be inspired by something that you do. And they may think of being a different way. Or they may, I don't know, pick up some trash or say hello to somebody. Because you never know. You could brighten somebody's day. Again, the basics of charity, how a smile could be charity. And that's really powerful. Mm-hmm. Right? And so thinking about that, when I'm walking around like sad and gloomy, I'm not even giving somebody like a smile. And so the basics. But yeah, I feel like, again, religious communities, we need to be doing more work. Right? Especially in our communities. Again, I don't think we should be having any conversation about sleeve length, pant length, until there are no hungry people in our communities. I'm sorry, it's just the way I feel. And I will end with that.
Thank you.
Thank you.